are on part number 3 for our hymn histories. So we're going to look at Martin Luther this evening. Martin Luther was not only considered to be a radical theologian, he was also a very talented songwriter. And he wrote not only lyrics, but also the music for his song. In the last program, we looked at the background and the history and the development of hymns. So tonight, I want to consider some of the greatest hymnists that time has revealed. And these two we're looking at this evening are just the beginning. These hymnists are very well known, to us anyway, because of the hymns that they wrote. Earlier we looked at the history and the development of hymns, but in these beginning programs we want to look at the hymnists first, the songwriters, and then we'll consider the hymns that they wrote. And then later, I want to look at some of the most popular hymns that are known to us, and then look at the background of the writers and some of the circumstances that prevailed when the hymns were written. There are some awesome stories behind many of the hymns that we sing today. And so we want to look at those stories. And when possible, within copyright restraints, we'll listen to the songs being sung and played. So we'll get right on into Martin Luther. Martin Luther was born in 1483, and he died in 1546. The best known hymns that were written by him include A Mighty Fortress Is Our God. That one we are familiar with. It's in our hymnal. And we're going to listen to a very special rendition of that this evening. And I'll tell you why it's really special a little later. Then Out of the Depths I Cry to You is another one. Never heard of that one before. From Heaven Above to Earth I Come. So there's only 3 that I was able to find that Martin Luther wrote. And, of course, the first one is the one that's well known to us today and is in our hymnal. And there are other hymnals, of course, that it's in. I think it may even be in the red ABA hymnal that we have as well. Martin Luther was born in Eisleben, Germany. He received his master's degree in 1505, and then he enrolled in law school on July the 17th, 1505. He left law school to become an Augustinian monk. So he became a priest, a Roman Catholic priest. He attributed this decision to being nearly struck by lightning on July the 2nd in 1505. Because of this incident, he became terrified of death and divine judgment. So in 1507, he was ordained to the priesthood. In 1508, he was teaching theology at the University of Wittenberg. In 1512, he was awarded a Doctor of Theology degree. From 1510 to 1520, he lectured on the Psalms, Hebrews, Romans, and Galatians. He became convinced that the Roman Catholic Church, shortened to RCC, was corrupt and had lost sight of the central truths of Christianity. He felt that the most important RCC error was on the doctrine of justification. His view was that salvation is a gift of God's grace attainable only through faith in Jesus Christ. Now, I wish he would have gone that far with the rest of his doctrines. He just didn't go far enough to get away from the Catholic Church. Of course, the Lutheran Church is named after him. Justification was entirely the work of God, unlike the RCC view that the righteous acts of believers are performed in cooperation with God. In other words, the Roman Catholic Church didn't think that, I guess, God was strong enough and able to bring about justification, so he had to have a little help, according to the Roman Catholic Church. The Roman Catholic Church theology stated that faith alone could not justify man. Man must be active in charity and good works for this to happen. These good works could be obtained by donating money to the church through the sale of indulgences. And this really became a tool, a weapon over the heads of members of the Roman Catholic Church. Which reminds me of a funny I heard one time. Little boy's daddy died, purgatory. So a little boy went to the priest and he said, "What do I need to do to get my daddy out of purgatory?" Well, the priest told him, he said, "Well, you bring X number of dollars here and we'll see about getting him out." So the little boy worked and slaved away, got the money and gave it to the priest. And the priest said, "Well, this will get him part of the way out." Said, he's not completely out yet. So if you bring in a little bit more money, we'll see what happens. And so the little boy went and saved and worked his fingers to the bone and got the amount of money that the priest had said. So he took it to the priest, and the priest said, this gets him almost out. Said, he's up to his knees now. The little boy said, "Oh, well," said, "daddy's a big, strong man. He can jump the rest of the way out." So the sale of indulgences really became a big thing in the Roman Catholic Church. But the money was then used to rebuild St. Peter's Basilica. Luther protested the sale of indulgences. The sale of indulgences was nothing more than works for salvation. On October the 31st in 1517, he wrote a letter and included what was later known as the 95 Theses. He nailed it to the door of a cathedral, supposedly, legend says. This became a catalyst for the Protestant Reformation. With the help of the printing press, the 95 Theses spread through Germany within 2 weeks. Now imagine that. This is in the 1500s. And his thesis being spread throughout the entire nation of Germany in 2 weeks, that's pretty astounding. And then throughout Europe within 2 months, and that's even more astounding. Roman Catholic Church responded on June the 15th in 1520 by warning Luther to recant the 95 Theses within 60 days or he would risk excommunication. In other words, they would kick him out of the Catholic Church. Of course, we know that he refused to do so. So, on January the 3rd in 1521, Martin Luther was excommunicated from the Roman Catholic Church. One of the most important benefits of the Reformation movement was the rediscovery of congregational singing. Congregational singing. Luther is to have said, "I wish to compose sacred hymns so that the Word of God may dwell among the people also by means of songs." He also said, "I would allow no man to preach or teach God's people without a proper knowledge of the use and power of sacred song." I commend him for that. His most well-known hymn is "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God." It's believed to have been written between 1527 and 1529, and it's based on Psalm 46. So Psalm 46, 1, "To the chief musician for the sons of Korah, a song upon Alamoth. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore will not we fear, though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea. Though the waters therefore roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof." Now, I'll pause here just a minute. You see that next word, Selah? That is not spoken, unless maybe you're listening to a narration of it, and then you might want to put it in there just for the sake of people knowing it's there. But it carries with it the same connotation as a musical rest. There's a pause. So this tells me that this psalm was written either to be sung or chanted. And they would pause right at the end of verse number 3. There is a river, the streams whereof shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her, and that right early. The heathen raged, the kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice, the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. And then there's another pause. Come, behold the works of the Lord, what desolations he hath made in the earth. He maketh wars to cease unto the end of the earth. He breaketh the bow and cutteth the spear in sunder. He burneth the chariot in the fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth. Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. And then we have another pause. And that's the end. The song, A Mighty Fortress is Our God, has been called the Battle Hymn of the Reformation. There are several theories concerning its origin. One, that it was sung by Luther and his companions as they went to the Diet of Worms. Now, this Diet of Worms is not a dinner of worms that they're going to. This was a meeting called the Diet of Worms. Where they got those words, I have no idea. But us today, that doesn't sound too appealing, does it? Two, it was a tribute to a friend who was executed as a Protestant martyr. And three, it was sung by German Lutheran princes as they went to the Diet at which the Augsburg Confession was present. And four, it was composed in connection with German Lutheran princes' protest to Charles V, who wanted to enforce the Edict of Worms. Now, this edict would have been a proclamation or a law, I guess you would say, that was made at the Diet of Worms. We really do not know which of these, if any, are correct. There have been no less than 60 translations into English alone, in addition to other languages. The most popular English version was translated by Frederick H. Hedge in 1853. The recording that we're about to listen to is a man by the name of Wesley, and he had 176 singers and musicians scattered from around the world. He put them all together with the music and the singing. I tell you, it is excellent. We'll listen to this now.
A mighty fortress.
Now, I'm sure that it probably was not sung that way in Martin Luther's time. Now, let's go to a little different era of songwriting. Let's come all the way up now to the 19th century. George Bennard was born February the 4th in 1873 in Youngstown, Ohio. Although he was born in Ohio, he was raised in Iowa. He was one of six children. When George was 16, his father died. After his father's death, George supported his mother and his sisters as a miner. Very difficult and hard work for a young man. He became known as a persuasive speaker, sharp dresser, yet humble and sincere. At the age of 24, he became a minister in the Salvation Army. By 1898, he had conducted revival meetings throughout the Midwest, later transferring to New York. In 1910, he resigned from the Salvation Army to go out on his own as an evangelist. It was at this point in his life he began composing hymns. He played the guitar, but not the piano. He finally settled in Albion, Michigan, and opened his own hymn publishing company. When he died in 1958, it is said that his funeral was attended by 400 people. At his funeral, an organ rendition of "The Old Rugged Cross" was played. George Bennard wrote around 350 hymns. One has become very popular, still sung in churches today in the 21st century. That song is "The Old Rugged Cross." The song was first sung at the First Methodist Episcopal Church in Pokagon, Michigan in 1913. The church became known as the original O Rugged Cross Church. The hymn was popularized by the evangelist Billy Sunday with his nationally broadcasted radio show. By 1939, 15 million copies of the hymn had been sold. Bennard said on writing this hymn, "I seemed to have a vision. I saw Christ and the cross inseparable." He also said, "The inspiration came to me one day in 1913 when I was staying in Albion, Michigan. I began to write the O Rugged Cross. I composed the melody first. The words that I first wrote were imperfect. The words of the finished hymn were put into my heart in answer for my own need." The melody for the hymn came easily, but he labored over the words. The words came weeks later. He said, "I sat down and immediately was able to rewrite the stanza of the song without so much as one word failing to fall into place. I called in my wife," he said, "took out my guitar, and sang the completed song to her. She was thrilled." The Old Rugged Cross. We're going to listen to this hymn now that's sung and recorded by the Temple Baptist Church in Powell, Tennessee.
Thank you.
and never get tired of hearing that old song sung. And I would not be surprised that it's pretty close to what George Bennard wrote. I have not been able to find so far any of the other 349 hymns that he has written. We may have some more in our hymn book, I'm not really sure. This one was the most popular song that he wrote. Even today, almost 100 years since he wrote it, it is still very popular and good to listen to.